Ladies and gentlemen, the Knights and Lady of the Head Table and Guest of Honor.
The cheap seats have talked already. Good evening, Mr. Provenzano.
And Deer Hunter.
Mr. Christie. I've worked so hard to think of something entertaining to say about Bill. Honest to God, it's been like 3 weeks since I really knew this moment was coming. And try as I might, I can't think of one redeeming feature that I can talk about. You know, most people you either dislike enough that you can really slam them, or you like enough that you can be complimentary in the way you tease them. Bill is so completely ambivalent to all of that. Now, this is a man who deems himself to be a good friend of mine because he asked me to do this. He writes me a letter once a year to ask me for free advertising. And he writes me a letter once a year to say thanks and see you next year. So at that rate, I feel truly blessed to have Bill as a friend. And look at you, you poor buggers. I mean, a whole room full of people with nothing to do on a Thursday night. I mean, well, your social calendar's so bereft of anything. I mean, reruns on TV would have beaten this, and it wouldn't have cost you money. Have the children gone home, by the way? Just checking. I talked to you about Bill, but I've got to talk to you about a couple little stories that affect me a little more deeply. Besides, I'm way more interesting than Bill is. And I'm skinnier.
You looked in the mirror?
So, a little while ago, I moved out into the country, and I lived a boyhood dream. I managed to find myself buying a lawn tractor. Now, I've never been on a lawn tractor in my life, and I tell you, it was a life-changing experience. 23 horsepower, fire engine, red headlights, oh, they have 42-inch deck. It was just a killer. Well, they put it in the yard at my house, and I was reading the instructions sitting on the tractor, and there's 14 steps that you have to go through to purge the transmission before it's safe to operate. And I thought, well, that's all right. So I'm sitting on the tractor, and I'm reading the first instruction, because I had to keep the instruction manual there because I couldn't remember all the steps. And I did the first thing it said, and the goddamn tractor took off like a rabbit, and I hadn't read the part where the brake was. Lawn tractors are 35 inches tall. And the reason that's important is because my deck is 30 inches off the ground. So I'm getting to that part. So me and the tractor came to a shuddering stop underneath the deck, wedged under the deck. I only tell you this story because you have to flash forward a little bit. And 2 weeks ago, I was driving my wife to work. It was 7:45 in the morning, and it was really dark, and she was chatting. She had nothing to do with what happened next, and she's in Belleville, so she can't hear me tell this story. But we were driving along, and we hit a deer. So this past weekend, I thought, you know, God, Grace, my head was in my hands. I was sitting at the dining room table, and I was thinking, you know, what the hell else can happen to me? I mean, wreck the lawn tractor, it no longer works, can't cut grass anymore, wipe out the car, did $11,000 damage to a Hyundai, and I would have thought it was humanly impossible to do $11,000 damage to a Hyundai. I thought you'd have to wreck two of them to get there. But all that to say, these two horrific events in my life, and I said, you know, what the hell's going to happen? You know, because bad things come in threes. And Grace, so, yeah, she looks up and says, well, don't worry about it. Isn't this the week you have to have dinner with McCracken?
Well, that didn't take long.
Bill is blessed with a lot of women in his life, I must tell you. And most of the ones that I talked to didn't have a complimentary thing to say about him. As a matter of fact, MJ, his sister, came up to me earlier this evening and begged me not to tell the story that she told me while she was drunk at an Italian hall dance. True story, you can't make this stuff up. And she was telling me about how she had to lie to Coach Cava when he'd phone because he'd check in on Bill to see if he was in for curfew, and she'd tell the coach, like, oh, yes, Coach, he's in bed sleeping. It's not very good, making a sister lie like that. I was talking to Cindy Downey, and she was telling me that she still can't celebrate Christmas because of the 12 days of Christmas email that you sent to her. It scarred her for life. Apparently, I hit a resonant chord in the room. Everybody knows what kind of emails that Bill sends. But I would be remiss if I didn't reflect for a moment on Bill's hockey career. He has the distinction of having the shortest NHL career on record. It lasted 15 seconds when the Pittsburgh Penguins gave him a tryout.
Minute and a half.
So he decided he would try to relive his glory with Ronnie Maraska and a bunch of fellas who'd get together and play hockey, just recreational hockey. And so Bill came back out, and as the story goes, Bill was in the mood to, rebuild himself and become the temple of a god that he is, and he went to the arena, and he was all dressed up and ready to skate. On the first break, a guy comes down the left wing, Bill's playing defense, and the guys on the bench, the excitement is just peaking because they're ready to say, you know, Bill's going to handle this guy. He's going to take him out. He's going to hit the boards with him. And the next sound you knew was Bill was flat on his ass, throwing his stick at the guy as he skated by, as the fella scored. Bill never went back. That was his final moment in hockey. He realized his day had come and gone. He's called a teddy bear by the people at the United Way. He's also scarred Debbie Escott for life because we used to meet in the boardroom of the travel agency for the campaign team meetings. And Bill used to tell jokes that the ladies of the United Way still to this day shudder when they think of what he used to say in mixed company. I won't repeat them, you just have to take my word for it that they were hideous in nature and in size. Which brings me to my last point about Bill McCracken. Sorry, this is my 10 minutes, leave me alone. I'd been a young publisher in Thunder Bay, I hadn't been here very long, and I was involved with the United Way, and we had fallen on great difficulty because we needed a chair for the campaign. And I had met Bill very briefly. I said, just leave it to me. I think I know somebody who will at least think about it. And Bill didn't know me hardly at all. And I went into his office and I just said, you know what? We need somebody to stand up for the United Way. And without even batting an eyelash, Bill said, I will do that for you. And he was one of our most successful campaign chairs. So he's got great shoulders, he takes a good joke, but his heart has always been in the very right spot for Thunder Bay, and I'm just delighted to be here tonight to have some fun at your expense. Bill, congratulations.
Thank you, Chronicle Bruce. As opposed to comical. Pardon me. Second roaster of the evening, Pat Lang. Working hard at being my boss? How is someone so short a leader in the land of lumberjacks and longshoremen? Diminutive, but not dim. We've never seen eye to eye. She's just arrived from China, a traveler like McCracken. She does get around. Tonight, she's packing for McCracken.
Good evening, everyone, and I'm delighted to be here with you this evening and feel quite honored to have the opportunity to roast my good friend, Bill. And I just can't figure this out, how somebody as young as me ended up at this table with all these old men. Oh, it's going to be a good night, I can tell already. On my way up here, I couldn't decide if I was going to talk about their age or the fact that they look like such stud muffins up here, but what do you think? Which one should I have gone with? Anyway, I am going to begin by telling you a short secret. And the secret is that I'm incredibly nervous being up here this evening to roast my friend Bill. And the reason I'm nervous is that when I told my daughter that I had been asked to do this, she said, "Oh, Mom, I understand why you're nervous, because you're really not very funny." Well, it got better. When I told her I was going to use that line, she goes, "Oh, Mom, that's not what I meant. I didn't mean that you weren't funny. I meant that you weren't quick-witted." So I stand here before you this evening, hundreds of people, and I am neither funny nor quick-witted. So you can only imagine how much I need your support. So if I say anything that's mildly entertaining, please laugh. I've also never been asked to roast anybody in public, so I had to think of the word roast and the word Bill all in one sentence, and I automatically came up with, guess what? Food. Absolutely. And as I thought about that whole food analogy, I thought, gee, is Bill well done, as in aged? Is he medium rare, as in boring? Or is he rare, like fine wine? But in the end, I decided he was just like a roasted vegetable, crispy on the outside and soft and tender on the insides. How nice. And isn't that just the opposite of Colin Bruce, who's soft and round on the outside but a little prickly on the inside? Now, I could go on with those food analogies, but I do have a problem, and the problem that I have is that I hate the kitchen and everything that has anything to do with the kitchen, so instead I'm going to focus on travel and talk about my friend Bill and travel. First of all, Bob and I have only known Bill since we moved to Thunder Bay, so we really had to do some investigative work to find out who Bill really is. We do know that he is Mr. Travel, or rather Mr. YQT Travel, but we didn't know just how much he was really involved and truly connected to travel. So I thought I would take you down memory lane and look at a historical perspective with excerpts from Bill's travel diary. Oh, that was my slide from the food. So here is what Bill calls his travel diary, the Poseidon Adventure. To begin with, we found out that his travel career is based on impossible missions. I mean, really impossible missions. In his early days, did you know that Bill was the person who really got Canadians moving? He was a highly respected Canadian. But it was really Bill's hard work and dedication that got Canadians moving from coast to coast. Bill was there when it all started. Take a look at what we found in his travel album. Then there was his shipbuilding year. There's Bill in the foreground waiting for his ship to come in. And oh, how Bill liked to show off his plans and his travel itinerary. But we won't really go there because we know how that ended. Not long later, Bill was at the grassroots of a new and upcoming organization. Bill booked his passenger, and then because times were tough, he had to fly the plane too. Here he is beside the plane. Can you see him? Here's a better shot. Oh, I'm sorry, that's the co-pilot who wanted a free flight. But here he is, looking ever so suave and debonair and a little bit crispy. Did you know that Bill, as a pilot, was sought after by many? Bill was also a pioneer in futuristic travel. Futuristic times meant better times, so Bill could afford a whole crew to travel with him. Unfortunately, his futuristic travel came to an abrupt end as a result of change fees, rerouting, and cancel and change fees. He had to bow out of the trip. Fortunately, he was able to recalculate double occupancy for his traveling companions. While Bill is touted as Mr. YQT, he also dabbled in another business, show business. Bill has courage, especially when it comes to dealing with people in the travel business. Why, he was even chosen to travel to a spectacular city and meet a great wizard. And believe it or not, in keeping with Bill's travel diary, did you know he was the first choice to fly in this famous movie? He was selected for his superhuman abilities, not only to fly, but because he was superhuman abilities to book anyone, anywhere, anytime. As we said earlier, traveling with Bill is certainly a Mission Impossible or the Poseidon Adventure, but there was one trip that was truly a Mission Possible. Did you know that Bill, on one of his trips to Las Vegas, auditioned and became Cher's right-hand male dancer in her Vegas show? It's true, we have proof, once again, from his travel diary. So tonight, Bill, I have a friend in the audience. Is my friend here? Oh, there you are. Okay. Tonight we want to give you one more opportunity, Bill, to relive the moment, to actually turn back time. So with the assistance of my dear friend Tom Jones, oh, for heaven's sakes, with the real Tom Jones, please stand up. Or was it Tommy Lee Jones? Or perhaps Billy Lee Jones? Anyway, I'm not sure, but here tonight, all the way from Vegas, give it up, everyone, for Cher as she sings Bill's favorite song, Turn Back the Time.
If I could turn back time, oh baby. take back those words that'll hurt you, and you stay. I give them all to you. They'll love me, love me like you used to do. Oh.
I don't remember what I had for breakfast.
If I could find a way.
Give a hand for Bill.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here tonight. Thank Bill and Norma for making me part of this. At least I was going to say that before I saw the first two performances. And Colin, it's good that you're in the newsprint business, not the radio broadcasting or television broadcasting. And Pat, thank you for half a presentation. Good thing Cher was good. I do want to thank the kids that were here and gone, Nathan, Amy, and Erica, and Terry, your stories were just great, and I've had the pleasure of being part of sort of Easter Seals, but part of where they do a lot of their therapy, et cetera, and that's at George Jeffrey Center, is on the Capitol campaign there, and a lot of the kids that are in Easter Seals go there, and it's been a pleasure. I got to know Zach really well, and this kid can do a lot in his motorized wheelchair now. It's more than one by one, I can assure you. Anyway, I do want to, first of all, apologize to Councillor Brian McKinnon because Mr. Campbell forgot him, but it's okay. The Source newspaper people forgot him, too, in the election. Well, I guess not too many people here read the Source. Anyways, also nice to see the Provenzano table come in late, fashionably late, of course. Actually, they are playing Just Get In from Montreal. They were doing a little family business there. Are they getting up? This will be my last presentation. But I am allowed three questions, so I'll be okay. And what a distinguished head table it is. Brian Campbell, I've known since university. We were actually both Winter Carnival King candidates back in 1970-71. And clearly he made it and I didn't. And we all know Pat Lang is retiring next year. And she's a real dynamo at the college. But actually I'm surprised she lasted as long as she has. She's not that bright. I was on a plane boarding with her one day, and I'm going to get some stories about Bill in a second because it relates to travel as well, but Pat was in row 11, I was in row 10, and a gentleman got on a plane, it was in row 1, said, "Hi, Pat. Hi, Larry." And I said, "Hi," and Pat said, "Larry, who is that guy?" I said, "That's Jack Mallon." And she yelled out, "Hi, Jack," and I grabbed her arm, "Pat, you can't say that on a plane." True story, Pat? Yeah, right. And another time, I was going to work in the morning, and my wife wanted the car for the day, so she was coming with me, and she just threw some sweats on and didn't have any makeup on, and her hair was all disheveled. She put a hat on top, and I had to go get some money, so I got to buy lunch. So we went to the Alloy Drive branch of the Royal Bank, and I was going through the drive-thru, and there's a lady in front of me getting out of her car in the drive-thru. Well, it's Pat. So I rolled down my window and said, my wife says, "Don't say anything. I work there." She did work there, actually. At any rate, I yelled out the window, "Hey, lady, it's a drive-thru. You get it?" So Pat, of course, comes back, says, looks in the car to see what it is. "Oh, Larry, it's you." Looks at my wife. "Hi, Kathy." Kathy used to work quite a bit at the college, but really reduced her hours after that. Another true story, right, Pat?
Yes.
Anyway, Michael Power and I obviously didn't get the memo about the zoot suits either.
Obviously not.
But I've done this dinner before. I emceed Gordy Crompton's, and I was actually emceed in sort of fifth choice of being the MC. First it was Tom Jones, and Tom was getting one of his organs replaced at the time, so couldn't make it. It was going to be Lord Gilbart, and Lloyd couldn't make it because he couldn't fight his hair that day. And then we had Gordy's daughter to do it, and she couldn't do it. And John Brian Gardner was very involved with the Easter Seals, and he was going to do it. And John said, "No, maybe Larry, you could do it." So I was the fifth choice to be MC behind, you know, a funeral home director. They give you a real lot of, encouragement, this Easter Seal group. In fact, if you open up the program today, my name's spelled wrong. So thank God the election's over and the Easter Seals weren't running the campaign with the ballots. And it's so good to hear our new mayor-elect, Keith Hobbs, say that councillors are now going to work 6 days a week, which would be one less day than we're working now, so I'm feeling pretty good about that. And I didn't want to leave out our last member of the head table, Michael Power, the only NHL hockey player, the real hockey player on the dais, also a star of the LU men team and one of our top 40 under 40 people. Of course, Colin Bruce is one of our bottom 60 over 60 group. I've known Michael for a long time. He was a stock boy at A&P when I first met him and playing midget hockey at the time, and he's done very well. And so I do want to congratulate him and hope he's not going to pick on me. Actually, Michael, coaching his son's team, they were playing at the Gardens last week during the LU game, and a guy called Trevor in the audience who keeps texting Michael, in fact, you should turn your BlackBerry off, Trevor, is the other coach, and their team played, and it was 1-0 for Trevor's team. Unfortunately, Michael, not your team. But about a year ago, Trevor was on the ice. They were picking up pucks, and about from 90 feet away, he took a shot with one of those rubber pucks and hit Michael right in the groin. So Michael didn't go on the ice last week in the second period, I noticed. Anyway, it's, as I said, a pleasure to be here. We're here to roast Bill McCracken again. Obviously, all of us didn't get the same email because the first two people were pretty kind. I'm not going to be quite as kind, but these are all true stories. It's actually a very special week for Bill, not because this party tonight, not because it's Remembrance Day, but it's the week that the clock changes time. And you got to remember, Bill played his whole hockey career without a helmet. Bill has a lot of trouble with this time change. In fact, I'm pleased to see he's here tonight, but I'm sure Norma got him here. You never remember spring forward, spring back, fall forward, or one of his usual parties, just fall on my face. But I think he's got it figured out. Ooh. Somebody's been to your parties. Actually, it's good to see a couple of people I used to deal with when I was using your travel agency, Katie Zuber and Norm McDonald here, and saw them mature in your organization, as I thought you would, but you didn't. When, of course, Bill lives close to Sweet Johnson, and Sweet, if anybody knows, Sweet is very cheap. So cheap. He cuts his Viagra pills in half to make them last longer. So Bill tried that for a while. Wasn't working, so he saw some of the ads on TV for Cialis. And he's been waiting for a couple years for that 4-hour erection they talk about on TV. Hasn't happened yet, but Norman's had to call 911 twice. Now, don't let me alarm you. It wasn't for medical purposes. It was because she was phoning the police, because she was charging Bill with assault with a dead weapon. Bill made his name in the travel business, and that actually quite frankly surprises me. I thought Pat wasn't too bright, Bill's even less bright. I'm at the airport one day with my wife. We're going on a trip to Toronto. Bill comes in behind us, kind of disheveled. He says, "Larry, I'm running late. I didn't have a chance to go to the bank. I forgot my wallet. Can you lend me $200? Okay, sure. As soon as I get a line, Bill, I'll go to the ATM at the airport. Gave him $200. I'll pay you back, sure. Well, we go up, we're going through security, and Bill's behind us again. And he can't find his boarding pass. He's only moved from the bottom floor to the second floor at the airport, and he can't find his boarding pass. My goodness. Okay, he finally finds it. Then we're walking out to the plane. My travel agent and my wife and I, his briefcase falls open and papers are flying all over the tarmac. My travel agent, how did he ever make it? Give you another example of that. Bill and Norma were heading to Florida one year and they were going points. So they were going to a couple intermediate stops on the way getting there, but it was gonna be business class. So Bill said, let's go to Hamburg before we go. And they did and headed over to go through security. And Bill says, Norma, get the boarding passes. And Norma says, you've got them, Bill. No, you've got them, Norma. No, you've got them, Bill. So Bill figures he's lost them. So back he goes to the restaurant. He's going through garbage. Norma's waiting and waiting, and finally Bill shows up with ketchup up to his arms. I've been through two garbage bags full of stuff. I can't find the boarding passes. Norma opens her purse. There are the two boarding passes. Bill is not a happy camper. Again, my travel agent. So, they're in Dallas now, on one of the many stops they're in. Bill's doing a little reading, Norma's doing a little reading. Bill's thinking, you know, that plane should have been called about 30 minutes ago. I wonder what happened. Looks up and realized the gate has been changed. It's the departure time, he's got about 2 minutes to get to the gate. So O.J. McCracken and spouse are heading through the airport. Jumping over bags and chairs, and he make it. Bill is not a happy camper. He's not talking to Norma. Well, they get into Tampa Bay. Everything's not bad. In the meantime, just before they get there, Bill says, could you take care of my wallet? Can you put it in your purse? No problem. So they get to the Tampa airport. They're going through, getting the bags. He says to Norma, Norma, get the bags. I'll go get the rental car. So, of course, Bill goes and gets the rental car lined up. Comes time to pay. No wallet, because Norma's got it. So back he goes about 45 minutes later and gets to see Norma, and she says, where's the car? I can't get it because you got my wallet. Another reason Bill was not too happy, but they survived. Anyway, that was my travel agent. So again, you know, you have to wonder how good was he when you see that kind of incident take place. Another time we were in a Toronto airport, Bill and I, and sitting having a drink before we got the plane to Toronto, or to back to Thunder Bay. And there was a guy there, and I said, Bill, he looks familiar. He's got to be a hockey player. So he left a couple times, came back, and finally Bill said to him, you're a hockey player, eh? And the guy says, yeah, how'd you know? He says, tractor tires. And for you that aren't initiated, that means stitch marks that look like tractor tires on your face. And Bill finally got his name, and it was Brad Smith who played for them. And so it was an opportunity to meet Brad. Thanks to Bill. Bill was also invited to an Air Canada golf tournament in BC, and he thought it'd be great to go out and see the grandchildren. So they asked him, Bill, what's your handicap? 25. Well, Bill, you can't play in this tournament with a 25 handicap. We'll have to give you an 18. You can't play any higher than that. Okay. So the grandchildren are there to cheer him on. Bill goes out, hitting the ball out of bounds, in the rough, everywhere except on the fairway. Grandchildren are cheering, go, Papa, go, Papa. And everybody's looking at them, do you know what he's doing? And, of course, he didn't, but finally the tournament was over and the children were finally figured out they shouldn't be cheering Papa's shots into the woods. And the pro, who didn't say anything all day to Bill, said to him, well, thank you, enjoyed playing with you. And Bill says, any advice? He says, well, do you have a regular job as well as golfing? And Bill says, yes, I do. He says, well, that's good. Bill says, any advice? He says, yep. He says, I'd take 3 months off and then retire from golfing. Again, a true story. So, you know, he praises himself as a pretty good golfer, but I'm not sure. But Bill has all these really interesting sayings he's talked to me about over the years, and we've known each other since high school. One of his is, marriage is like a deck of cards. It starts out in the beginning with hearts and diamonds, and after a while, you're looking for a spade and a club. I guess that time change has affected more than you, Bill. People in the back of the room will get it a little bit later this evening. Anyways, trying to been hip lately because he's, you know, really trying to get into the computers. And he, once you're on this list, he sends you a computer message every day. But he's trying to be impressive to the grandchildren and his family. He's lining up gifts for them, so he's really into the iPads, the iPods, you know, learning all the lingo, et cetera, and he's getting them Christmas presents. Then he made the mistake of telling Norma he's got a computer for her called the Iron. That's iron, if you say it another way. Yeah, thank you, Bill. And that'll go with her other network devices at home. I cook, I clean, I wash, which usually leads to I nag. Anyway, Bill's sister MJ kind of sensed a little bit of friction in the marriage, so as her present to Bill and Norma, she bought a weekend at the spiritual spa. And celibacy, if I can just explain it before I close, that can be from two sources. One is self-imposed or the other is circumstances. Well, Bill reluctantly goes on a Friday night. It's going to last from Friday night to Sunday at noon. There's eight couples. Bill's just rolling his eyes when the leader gets up. And of course he says, you know, I don't want to talk about stereotypes, but men do not know their mates as well as women know their mates. And he says, let me ask you, gentlemen, what is your wife's favorite flower? Bill leans over to Norma and says, loud enough so everybody can hear because he's really impressed. He says, it's all purpose, isn't it? That's when Bill's celibacy began. Didn't need the Viagra or the Cialis anymore. Anyway, as I said, Bill's a pretty good hockey player. He played for the, as one of the pictures showed, for the Mars in 67 when they played the Toronto Marlboros in the Canadian Junior Championships. And I talked to two of his hockey mates from his junior days, two opponents and one coach. And all said Bill was a hard worker and an honest player. And, you know, that's... You know, despite the fact that I've given up all the shots, that's how he's turned out in life. He's a real honest guy, he works hard, and, you know, he's been a great asset to our community. The one last thing I want to say, Bill, and I'm going to lend this to Michael, because when I took Lloyd Gilbart's place, and, you know, everybody knows Lloyd wears a rug, I wore this during the whole dinner, and since... Michael and I are follically challenged. If he wants to borrow it, he's quite welcome to, too. Anyway, Bill, I just want to wish you the best. It's great that you're up here and going to take some shots at us now, but I want to thank you, and thank you for being so good to Easter Seals.
I'll pay for that regularly. I should introduce at this very point Michael Power, the anchor man on the panel this evening, and we haven't really had a fist fight yet, so things are going swimmingly. Michael is allegedly brilliant. He's a visionary building clusters of enterprises no one really understands. He's become quite a bit of an immigration consultant specializing in importing big brains. That would be big brains to those who haven't had any wine. He will surpass Fred as a builder. I put money on it. He's always in a hurry. Throws a mean elbow in the regional hallways. Wears his hair on the inside, but he has an option tonight, apparently. And he'll be whacking McCracken.
Good evening, everyone, and thank you, Campbell, for that kind introduction. It will be the last time you and I share pleasantries tonight. I was called by Bill McCracken some time ago and asked if I'd be prepared to roast him as part of the Easter Seals annual fundraising drive. Naturally, I said, I don't really know you that well, Bill. So what would I have to offer by way of a speech? We've connected at various fundraisers, but what could I offer in terms of real, meaty, juicy dirt that would stimulate an audience for 10 to 15 minutes? Bill didn't share my concern, but rather offered to write my speech and provide me with photos. A narcissist? You decide. So I decided to ask around in an attempt to learn more about Bill, his intricacies, his warts, his hidden secrets. What I uncovered, ladies and gentlemen, is shocking. Absolutely shocking. I'm not here tonight to toast Bill McCracken. I'm not here like the other pansy-ass speakers to roast Bill McCracken. I'm here, friends, to wake you up to the fact that our community of Thunder Bay is being run, no, manipulated, by none other than the infamous Scottish Mafia. Bill, or should I call you William Milad McCracken, is the ringleader of the local Loch Lomond Illuminati. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm in grave danger here tonight by bringing you this message, but I felt compelled to blow the cover on this story as a brave young member of the Scottish Illuminati, a key member of William McCracken's inner circle for the past 10 years, has come to me and shared the details of this extremist and underworld group. This group that we know today as our community leaders. You think you know the whole story? Think again.
Secrets, cover-ups. You think you know the whole story? I've been a board chair, a goalie, the leading scorer on the Boston Pizza Canadians, a cancer care VP. I've heard things that will blow your mind.
Now, exposes the secret society of elite power brokers that pulls the strings and calls the shots.
Talking about the control of absolutely everything on the planet.
It's not a fantasy. They meet in plain sight.
This is the scene of the crime.
Only no one knows what goes on behind closed doors.
They say we're not secret, we're private.
I need you to move off the property.
We're being kept well back from the building.
Until now. They control the money.
When you control the purse strings, you control the world.
They control the food.
They're poisoning our people.
They even decide who will live and who will die.
They want you dead.
They're out to kill me?
And their most lethal plot may be underway right now. The group that runs the world.
I'm Michael Power, and I'm exposing the Thunder Bay Scottish Mafia, the Loch Lomond Illuminati.
So ladies and gentlemen, I should take a minute to explain what the Scottish Illuminati is all about, especially given we have learning-impaired colleagues here tonight like Trevor Mikus, Murray Wahlberg, and Darren Henderson. The Illuminati, plural for Latin illuminatus, or enlightened, unlikely Bill, refers specifically to a secret society founded on May 1st, 1776 by the Scottish owners of what was the Northwest Fur Trading Company, known today as Fort William Historical Park. In modern times, it's also used to refer to an organization which acts as a shadowy power behind the throne, allegedly controlling community affairs through present-day governments, corporations, and in this context, the Illuminati is believed to be the masterminds behind the events that will lead to the establishment of a new world order, or more specifically, the new world order here in Thunder Bay. So cast your eyes, ladies and gentlemen, on the head table tonight. Cast your eyes on the key members of the Loch Lomond Illuminati. Brian Campbell, Senior Executive, Confederation College, responsible for government affairs. Coincidence? Scottish! Patricia Lang, President, Confederation College, Scottish Illuminati. Larry McHebert, former CEO of Thunder Bay Hydro and counselor who was large, counselor at large. He dropped the Mick to be less obvious about his ancestry, but we uncovered the truth. Scottish! Colin of the Clan Bruce, publisher of the newspaper, Scottish and clearly Illuminati. And ringleader William Bill McCracken, former owner of the Illuminati Front, Thunder Bay Travel, and Scottish. But it doesn't stop here. Let me reveal others. Many sitting amongst you tonight, they hold key positions of power in our city, and they work at all costs to move their Scottish agenda and their twisted view of the world forward. Mr. Don Campbell, President and CEO, TBATEL, Scottish. Ms. Lynn Peterson, apologies. Ms. Lynn Peterson, former mayor, soundly Scottish. Dr. Brian Stevenson, president, vice chancellor, Lakehead University, Scottish. Mr. Scott McFadden, chief executive officer, airport authority, Scottish. Ewan Downey, president, CEO, Premier Gold Mines, Scottish. Ian Angus, counselor at large and the most frugal Scotsman in the group. He's a socialist, for heaven's sake. Mr. Brian McKinnon, city councillor and wind energy expert, Scottish. Fraser Dougal, Dougal Media Group, you guessed it, Scottish. Dr. Chris Allison, physician, and don't let him tell you that he's Irish, that's his beautiful bride. He's Scottish and Illuminati. And the most Scottish Illuminati of all, Robert, Don, and Alexander Patterson. The Patterson boys, all Scottish through and through, and you guessed it, members of the Loch Lomond Illuminati. So ladies and gentlemen, we've been led to believe there is an Italian mafia cell existing here in Thunder Bay. I take you to the July 10th, 2010 Toronto Star article, Italian Mafia Probe Shines Light on the GTA Mob. A top mafia boss flew to Toronto in an underworld mission aimed at quelling tensions between the GTA mobsters and rebellious underlings in Thunder Bay. It's the mother of all investigations, Antonio Nicasso, a GTA author, has written. Thunder Bay was in the bad books of superiors in Toronto because they were considered indiscreet and took on new members without authorization. Let me tell you on this stage tonight, my investigation has proven this is Scottish crap. My principled and values-led friends, Tony and Tullio Provenzano, and you guessed it, former and sacked Easter Seals MC, Jim Cheech Morrow, have been living under this shadow, this cloud of doubt, for many months now. This is a smoke and mirrors effort deliberately done at the behest of McCracken to keep a focus on his Italian friends and allow his Scottish Illuminati colleagues to thrive. Colin Bruce, publisher of the Chronicle Journal, was secretly caught on tape by none other than a young Tim Camiso, fingered in the Toronto Star article, I might add, validating the presence of the secret society.
Well, it's a well-known fact, Sonny Jim, that there's a secret society of the five wealthiest people in the world, known as the Pentaverate, who run everything in the world, including the newspapers, and meet tri-annually at a secret country mansion in Colorado known as the Meadows.
So who's in this Pentaverate?
The Queen, the Vatican, the Gettys, the Rothschilds, and Colonel Sanders before he went tits up. I hated the Colonel with his wee, beady eyes and that smug look on his face. Oh, you're gonna buy my chicken, oh! He puts an addictive chemical in his chicken that makes you crave it fortnightly, smart arse!
And it doesn't end here. Larry McHebert, always known for his aggressive manner and lack of emotional intelligence, has already gone after our mayor-elect because he isn't Scottish. Take a look.
Brothers and sisters are natural enemies, like Englishmen and Scots, or Welshmen and Scots, or Japanese and Scots, or Scots and other Scots. Damn Scots! They ruined Scotland!
You Scots sure are a contentious people.
You just made an enemy for life!
Do I have your attention now? Are you believers yet? You can't argue with footage that's this compelling. This isn't manipulated. Our lives are a string of manipulations. Let me share a few more examples, and they all link back to that Scottish braveheart himself, the Robert Roy McGregor of Northwestern Ontario, William McCracken. The Illuminati infiltrate and take over organizations of all kinds. Colleges to telephone companies to universities, government organizations, and they turn them to their own ends. They have agents and sleepers planted everywhere. Many of these people have no idea who they're really reporting to, Campbell. Others are active members of the conspiracy working their way even deeper into the fabric of society. They control the schools in order to make sure the young people learn to enjoy strange tuneless music and weird outlandish games, and they dress oddly. They try to recruit the best and the brightest young people as agents to ensure the next generation of conspiracy. Gold, ladies and gentlemen, is now forecasted at $3,300 an ounce, and we have the cheapest Scot amongst us running a gold company. Irony? Conspiracy? They constantly feud amongst themselves in war with other groups and organizations. Their first means of dealing with opposition is to buy it off. To any group as rich as the Illuminati, a few million dollars doesn't mean anything. By the way, there is no gratuitous advertising here for T-Batel. The Illuminati have embraced technology. Their files of information are much more useful when backed by the power of the computer. They're also conditioning everyone to believe that computers are so complicated and dangerous that only experts can play with them. They keep everyone, yes, everyone, under constant surveillance. Every time you fill out a questionnaire, you're weaving another strand of net that binds the world. Again, no gratuitous advertising for T-Batel. And every wire in your house is a potential pathway for Illuminati messages, attacks, or controlling rays. Did you ever stop to think about how many wires lead to your house? Don Campbell has at T-Batel. They send secret messages through the newspapers and airwaves, in classified ads, and even buried in news reports. They have other, even stranger forms of secret communication. Next time they try threats, danger to possession, status, or loved ones is dissuaded, many would-be foe of the Illuminati. And of course, murder is an ancient political weapon. The Illuminati have been responsible for some of the most shocking political assassinations of all time. Poor Frank. Frank. They replaced people with doubles. For many years, they recruited lookalikes who would serve their ends. Now their perfectly cloning technology will let them replace anyone. And those who can't be dealt with any other way are discredited or driven mad. The Illuminati conspiracy is hundreds, if not thousands, of years old, and many of famous names of history have been illuminated or Illuminati agents. And indeed, all of history is nothing more than an outside view of the schemes and struggles of the Loch Lomond Illuminati. They control the news media, so you hear what they want you to hear. Any event that doesn't fit into their program will quickly be hushed up. In particular, they control television. They don't permit intelligent shows to survive. Good evening, I'm Barry Third. They encourage mind candy that will keep people from thinking. The only reason good shows are permitted to appear at all is to convince intelligent people that nobody else likes such material and that there must be something wrong with them. Likewise, the entire energy crisis is an Illuminati invention. There's clearly no shortage of energy of a dozen different kinds, but plentiful free energy that must threaten the Illuminati power base. They encourage resistance to authority amongst young people and political dissidents to distract government attention and the real enemy within. Yes, that is you, Parker Jones. But when they reach a satisfactory level of control, they turn their efforts towards extinguishing independence and encouraging mindless obedience to whatever order comes from the Illuminati or their servants. They commit random atrocities, often sacking political veterans who have a vision for the future, just to make people vaguely confused, frightened, and paranoid. But Lynn Peterson doesn't need to worry about her political future. Lynn, there's always hope. You too can return to city council, just like your counselor at large friend, Ken Boschkoff. On the other hand, they maintain secret laboratories where they develop medical devices of all kinds. Their arcane investigations cause all sorts of mysteries. Ever wonder about the Loch Ness Monster? The Sleeping Giant? They're constantly experimenting with new types of mind control. They put drugs in our drinking water, flash subliminal messages during movies, and play instructions that you can't quite hear over supermarket loudspeakers. They experiment with microwaves and ultra-low frequency devices, except at Lakehead University until recently. And the Illuminati know weird sexual techniques undreamed of by the Kama Sutra.
Oh, do you find me sexy? Oh.
And the next time you spend too much money to buy something you didn't want or need, and it breaks in a week, you can be sure you've contributed to an Illuminati fundraising project. In every organization, there's a ringleader, the top boss, the clan chief, and the Scottish Mafia is no different. Bill McCracken represents all of the aforementioned covenants that make up the local Illuminati, and then some. His travel business was a front. He buys what he can't control. He manifests feuds. He sends secret and brainwashing messages through the airwaves and email. And how many in this room have unknowingly contributed to the proliferation of Illuminati messages through Bill's constant chain emails? Let's get a show of hands. Who here has enjoyed Happy Nipple Day? Featuring a series of bare-breasted women celebrating life. But this was actually a message to Illuminati colleagues to meet at Whitewater for a special tasting of the great Scotch Redbreast. Bill, as many know, is a real success in real estate and property development. He's recently completed a multi-million dollar project, the McCracken Castle in Kelowna, BC. This fortress is where he hosts his senior meetings of the Illuminati. We caught him on tape.
So, that must be
Bill McCracken's castle.
Do you think maybe he's compensating for something?
Many believe the art of the sauna was a finished creation. That's just what the Scots want you to believe. In fact, it was created in 1381 by a Scot as a forum to host secret meetings. Secret meetings. Because who wouldn't want to get together with other naked fat guys sweating all over one another, smacking one another with a fig? This hazing ritual must have been dreamed up by a Scot. Many of you have been invited to Bill and Norma's Surprise Lake Hideaway. This plantation is where Bill controls the Illuminati's every move and decision. If anyone steps out of line with the Illuminati direction, Bill sends them out on the lake for an afternoon of fun. Fun? You call this fun?
Exciting and new. Come aboard. Expecting you and love.
Just criminal.
The sweetest reward. Let it go. It floats back to you.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm sure this has been alarming. I look out on this audience tonight, and many of you are starting to question who you're sitting with and whether or not they are Scottish Illuminati. Looch? Scottish? Gino Arnone? Scottish? Anyone know about Tom Jones's whereabouts? Glasgow, perhaps? There is hope, though. There is light at the end of this dark tunnel. I speak now of our new mayor, Keith Hobbs, an Englishman, who has vowed a crackdown on all crime in this community. McCracken, you and your cronies don't stand a chance. Hobbs has vowed to connect the city police with the RCMP, the OPP, the NAP, the NRA, the NAACP, the IRA, and yes, the United States Marines, all in an effort to root out crime, the worst offenders being those aligned with your dubious movement. So, colleagues, I want to thank each and every one of you for humoring me with your laughter. I'm sure this presentation must have sounded like the rantings of a crazy man. But this is such an enjoyable and wonderful cause. Bill, thank you for allowing me and the other roasters to take advantage of you tonight. You have a heart of gold and you've done so much for our community. I ask each and every member of the audience tonight to reflect on Bill's biography in the Easter Seals program. I can't think of any other local resident who's done so much for local charities. Bill has stewarded the United Way, raised hundreds of thousands of dollars for our new hospital, an unbelievable supporter of our regional cancer program and Confederation College, and the list goes on. Bill, you're a hero to many. I do want to close by taking a moment to thank those who helped me pull this presentation together. Steve Coggle, a good friend, a graphic designer, Norma McCracken for her photo. The sauna photo was fantastic. And for arranging a special flight for a very special person, which now brings me to revealing our mole. The individual who stimulated tonight's presentation, helped me with the content, and more importantly, flew from Winnipeg to celebrate with Bill tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, a round of applause for Bridget Parker. Come on up here, Bridget, to give Bill a big hug.
You know, you did just fine until the end. Here. Thanks, Norm. I've been sitting all here all night with a glass of water. Anyways, what a team. I can't believe the effort that these people made to roast me and to make all in the name of Easter Seals and helping the kids with disabilities. The effort that was put forth by these 5 people was really well. I'm impressed. I mean, most of it was lies, but. Anyways, we'll start with, I just got a few things to say about each of them because there's not much to say about them. Colin Bruce is one of Thunder Bay's most influential people. You read his bio, he's everywhere. He's an excellent MC. He's a great guest speaker, as long as the topic is light. And you can stop his rhetoric and rambling. I am amazed that Colin did not choose radio or TV as a career, because when he gets the mic in his hand, he thinks he's Anderson Cooper. He's probably a better speaker than Anderson Cooper, but at least Anderson sticks to the topic and focuses on the issue. I hope I didn't hurt your feelings, Colin, but it's really very difficult to be critical of someone that makes the effort that you do to help everyone. It doesn't matter that you were a pot-smoking, long-haired hippie in the 60s. I mean, look how you've progressed. You got a haircut. Well done, Colin, and thank you for all that you do to make Northwestern Ontario a better place for us to live. Patricia Lang, born in Quebec to Irish parents. That would be Irish, not Scottish. By the last name of Sullivan. Pat is 100% bilingual, and Pat has been in Thunder Bay for the last 10 years. And I remember picking her up from the airport 10 years ago with Norma. As I recall, she was the cutest little pudgy thing that was all smiles. She actually looked happy to be here. We drove her around the city to look at places to rent, We drove her to restaurants for lunch and for dinner. We drove her to the college. We picked her up, drove her back to the airport, and this happened several times prior to her making her actual move. She never gave us a goddamn nickel. Oh, maybe she is Scottish. Norma and I were okay with that, with our newly acquired limo service. Gas was a little cheaper back then. And of course, we had very little difficulty taking time off work, as we were self-employed and the company ran smoothly without us. And we were able to write off all her meals for that cute little pudgy thing. What an appetite. She finally found a place to live, had her car shipped up from Southern Ontario, and drove to Thunder Bay with her husband, Bob. For all of you who know Pat personally, you know how she craves attention. So after she sneezes and lets out this manufactured screech that everyone gets the attention, well, she's finally given that up somewhat. She still does it, but she's getting over it. Bob and Pat, over the past 10 years, have grown into two of our best friends. And along with their daughter, Allison, and her new husband, Derek, we share a bond of genuine friendship that Norma and I and our family are very, very comfortable with. Pat has been a generous supporter of every charity that I and many of you have been involved in. She goes above and beyond the call of duty. Pat is retiring July, and I wish her all the very best in her future endeavors, wherever they may take her. Now, Bob was unable to attend this evening, but his friendship has reduced my life over the years with his determination, his take life one day at a time attitude, and his quiet, selfless demeanor. Every day that I see Bob, I ask the same question. How are you, Bob? His answer, oh, I can't complain, Billy. Bob is my hero. Larry Hebert. It was so nice to have Larry agree to be a roaster at this very important Easter Seals fundraiser. He is the only one here older than me. We went out to the Caribou for lunch last week, and Bob Stewart greeted us at the door. Hi, Bill, nice to see you again. And he extended his hand to Larry and said, nice to see you too, Mr. McCracken. Bill has told me a lot about you. I quickly corrected Bob and told him that Larry was not my father, but just a badly weathered friend. Alderman Hebert, or as the program says, Herbert, kind of matches Sherbert, has worn many hats over the years. He's been involved with just about every sport locally, but in particular, baseball. You may find this hard to believe, but a long, 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 long time ago, Larry was an excellent athlete. That was pre-food and booze. I remember well in the old sports celebrity dinner days when we invited professional athletes to speak at the events. This particular year, we had Dennis Hull of the Chicago Blackhawks, the same Chicago Blackhawks that our favorite son, Patrick Sharp, plays for today. Well, he was here to entertain us, and the first thing he said was, when I arrived at the airport today, I was greeted by Larry Hebert. If he was 2 inches taller, he'd be a perfect circle. And that's how that evening started. And that's the truth. Larry likes to be involved. He has to be busy. And over the years, he has been an intricate member of many organizations. And in several instances, he has been the spark that has kept the fire going. We are lucky to have Larry extending his efforts on our behalf, and I'm pleased to call him my friend. Michael Power is a young, handsome, energetic, athletic. He's an articulate speaker. He's got a beautiful wife and family. He appears to know an awful lot about the health care. He's in the newspaper. He's on the radio. He's on TV. He never stops talking. And I have been observing Michael over the past several years. I have decided that no one can talk that much and that well unless they're lying. Michael Power is a liar. I mean, how much of that stuff can we really believe? Michael lives in a beautiful home with a large yard that he uses a riding lawnmower to cut the grass. One day, as he was cutting the lawn, his neighbor came over to speak with him and expressed some concern over a tree that was in Michael's yard that was making a mess in his yard. Michael said he'd look after it. But because Michael is so busy with his trips to Toronto, his interviews with the media, where he lies, nothing happened with the tree. He's such a liar. Michael again went out on his riding lawnmower to cut the grass. Seeing Michael, his neighbor came out with an axe and demolished one of Michael's sprinkler heads. A fierce argument ensued in front of his neighbor's children and grandchildren, and Michael called the police. True story. Police came quickly to Michael's rescue to try and resolve the issue that, of course, would have never occurred in the first place if Michael had kept his word. He's such a liar. On a more serious note, we as a community are indeed fortunate to have someone with Michael's talents, energy, and skills working for us. Lakehead University alumni has recently published congratulations to Michael Power for being chosen one of Canada's top 40 under 40 for 2009.
Great job, Michael. And by the way, you really stretched that Scottish thing. Well, I jotted down a few words about Brian Campbell. It's okay, Brian. It's going to be nothing but the truth. Brian Campbell is the Executive Director, Government Relations at Confederation College. Brian, what exactly is that?
A bit of a liar myself.
You get to work every morning and do what? You call the government and say, "Hi, I'm Brian Campbell from Confederation College. Want to do lunch?"
Yes.
I know that you make time for lunch because I only receive your emails in the morning and afternoon. Where do you find those emails anyway? I don't think that they're part of your government relations.
I mean, McCracken?
Hello, buddy. But keep sending them. Well, I guess Pat must have you doing some things of importance. You seem to have been there forever. So when you're sending those emails and talking to your beautiful wife, Dallas, having lunch with the government, and being a yes man to Pat, I'm going to assume that you do other things of importance too. I was told that while you were growing up in Beardmore, you had a promising hockey career as captain of the Beardmore Blueberries. If only someone had told you that goalies were supposed to stay in the net. Congratulations for being your team's top goal scorer. Now, I've had the pleasure of listening to Brian at numerous functions at the college, at birthdays, anniversaries, weddings, and a great, great many charitable events where his quick wit and delightful sense of humor have entertained hundreds of people over the years. On behalf of the Easter Seal kids and myself personally, thanks for another great job, Brian. No tongue. Now I'd like to thank all of you who made the decision to support Easter Seals and help the children with disabilities. There are a lot of fundraisers all year long and several in the immediate future. We appreciate that you chose to be here tonight. I'd especially like to thank all the companies and organizations that purchased tables. Patterson Foundation, Thunder Bay Tell, Lowry's, Confederation College, Lakehead University, Dougal Media, Premier Gold Mines, RBC, Tom Jones Corporation, Canadian Tire Corporation, Thunder Bay Chronicle Journal, Thunder Bay Regional Health Sciences Foundation, Thunder Bay Regional Research Institute, Myers Norris Penny, and our Bearskin Airlines. I'd also like to thank Rennie and his fine staff at the Valhalla Inn for the great meal. I think somebody already thanked them, but I had this written down, so I have to do it. I mean, it was a great meal. Special thanks to Gino Arnone for saying grace, Hannah Craig for singing O Canada, John Tuco for his 8 years of caricaturing the roastee, and Ken Wilson for piping in the head table. Thank you to all the companies, organizations, and people that filled our silent auction table with all sorts of wonderful items, and to Porter Airlines and Bearskin Airlines for their generosity. I'd also like to thank my old good friend from our football team and his wife, Phil and Debbie Goujon, for flying in from Edmonton, Alberta. Thanks, buddy. And of course, this evening would not happen if it weren't for the tireless efforts of Rhonda Harrison of the Easter Seals Thunder Bay and her assistant. And may I say how proud and pleased I am of the huge effort that my wife, Norma, has given to help fill these tables. And for all your enjoyment here tonight, an enormous thank you to my esteemed roasters for doing such a great job of making all of those untrue stories. On behalf of the kids at Easter Seals, a very sincere thanks so very much.
and please drive carefully.